In fact, in Jain system also, a distinction is drawn between jiva, that is individual self, and its mind, manas. So he will be speaking on the concept of manas. And manas is at once an instrument of cognizing the inner as well as the outer world.
No,
so
sorry,
he will be speaking on that.
Sorry. His Holiness Sri Dalai Lama Ji and other scholars. Sorry, I could not prepare the PowerPoint on my subject. However, I give you its gist. Now, I need not mention the views of mind regarding other philosophies. And therefore, I will confine to Jainism. Now, Jainism, regarding mind, it is called Anindriya. It's a very important one. It is called Anindriya. So this, the term Anindriya does not mean that it is not a sense or Indriya, but it indicates that it has a comparatively lesser degree of sense. Now, this is called Ishidindriya, Manindriyantyai, Itha, Anindra. Now, the mind is also a means of knowledge. But it is dependent on other senses. For grasping external objects, it assists in knowing and perceiving the objects to other senses in the activities like remembrance, Smriti, Pratyabhigya, Uhapoy, and other factors. Now it consists of series of auspicious and inauspicious doubts. It apprehends all the objects, Sarvarth Grahanam Manah. Now it assists in thinking, Manyate, Chinyate, Manyate, Chintyate, and so on. Now it is indeed a common factor in all indirect cognitions. The object of other senses is fixed, but the mind is not confined to any of the physical qualities. The mental activities are material by nature. Mind is the quality of a pudgal, that is called matter. It is called drabhendriya, consisting of manovarna in Jain technical terminology. It spreads in entire body and assists in knowing and perceiving all the objects. Therefore, it is called the karan of soul. It's a very important one. Now, it is also called sanghi and antahkaran. It is also called matigyan. It is subtle, that means sukshma, and cannot be perceived. Indriya gochar. Now let me say the types of mind. So according to Jainism, mind is two types. One is physical mind, that is called drabhyaman, and another one that is called bhavaman. The physical mind is material, paudilik. And the bhavman, that is called chetanman. And the chetanman is the power of activity of the self to perform mental functions. The part of mind thinks, imagines, plans, discriminates, and takes decisions. The material mind, that means drabhyaman, becomes comparative, cooperative to chetanman. Without material mind, the chetan mind cannot perform its activities. In fact, it does not possess the power of knowledge. Therefore, the bhavman is called gyan, and gyan is the nature of soul. Therefore, it is included into soul. both the types of mind come together and perform the mental activities. They are Murt and Pudgal to certain extent. The Chetanman, or that means Bhavman, cannot be constructed through material atoms. If it is constituted through material atoms, it could not be destructed from the body. So therefore, Chetan or consciousness is the characteristic of soul. It never stays with the selfless body and bodiness. Bodiless Chetan or soul cannot be perceived. We in fact perceive the soul or Chetan if it stays with the body. The functioning of mind is the activity of soul, resulting from annihilation comes subsistence of physical karma. Now the concept of development as regards in Jainism, it may be noted that conceptual development of mind took place in Jainism. For instance, in the Nandi Sutra and Anyogadwar Sutra, the ordinary perception is confined to the five external senses. Mental cognition is not regarded as perception. But in the later stage, the apprehension of pleasure, pain, etc. are included into perception. In the Agamic period, feeling has no relation with the mind, but it is directly connected with the soul. Even the animals without mind, that means asangi jeev, feel pleasure, pain, etc. All the souls apprehend their own qualities independently in Jainism, while according to Nayayikas, the qualities of soul are cognized by the mind. The Vedant, Sankhya and Buddhist assign the qualities of pleasure, pain, etc. to mind only. But the Jainas are of view that they are qualities of the self mixed with karmic matter. Now let us understand the impact of mind on body and vice versa. The soul is formless, amurtic. We cannot perceive the soul. The body gets the expression of activities of mind. In other words, soul is the electricity and body is bulb. The power of knowledge is the characteristic of soul, and the instruments are the parts of body. The soul speaks through body. Likewise, soul adopts the matter and their movements through body. Without the soul, the thinking, speaking, and other activities cannot be happened, and without body, their expression cannot take place. Therefore, it is called drabnimittam hi sansarinam viryamuchyate. So our mind starts thinking and then adopts the favorable or unfavorable substances through drabhyaman or paudalikman. The unfavorable substances put harms to the body, and favorable substances bestow the benefits to the body. Now the function of mind is, what is the function of mind according to Jainism? The function of mind according to Jainism is to assist the senses for obtaining the knowledge or feeling. The Nandi Sutra says that the sense cognition is different from the mental cognition. The first is direct cognition, that means pratyaksha jnana, while the latter is indirect cognition, that is paroksha jnana. In the logical period, this definition is slightly changed from practical standpoint. All the types of indirect cognition except the agam are included into indirect empirical cognition, paroksha jnana. Now Aklang then clarifies the nature of direct and indirect cognition and includes all types of mental cognition in Shruti. As far as the sense cognition is concerned, he does not differ from the Nandi Sutra. Mati Jnana is exclusively related with the sense. The soul cognizes the object through the medium of senses without depending upon the assistance of mind. The instruments of Mati Gyan and Shruta Gyan are the senses and mind. Senses and mind. The senses and mind are not one and the same. One obtains the knowledge of substance in Mati Gyan through senses and mind, while Shruta Gyan depends on the word or hint. It is the Mati Gyan of one person. It is the Mati Gyan if one perceives the jar through vision only, and when it is known through word only, it is called Shruta Gyan. And also it is Vyabharik Pratyaksh in Jain tradition. The Mati Gyan is divided into four processes: Avagraha, Iha, Avaya, and Dharana. Now the difference, one is very important point. What is the difference between mind and soul? In this regard, it would be better if we try to understand the distinction between mind and soul. Now, according to Jainism, the mind does not possess consciousness, which is the exclusive characteristic of soul. Mind is not a permanent entity. It exists only when consciousness manifests as thoughts, desires, emotions, etc. Third, mind can have only one thought at a time, while the soul has power of plurality. The fourth, the mind derives the power from the soul and acts on a physical plane. The mind is influenced by the external world and body, external world and body, and then it influences the soul. The sixth one, in the emancipation state of the soul, the veil of physical karma disappears and the cycle mind ceases to exist. Now the point is whether the mind is included into senses. It may be noted here that mind in Jainism is included into the fold of senses to a certain limit. The Nayayikas are of view that mind is an independent substance, while the Sankhya philosophy includes the mind into senses. In Jainism, both the senses and mind are the causes of both Mati Gyan and Shruta Gyan. But the knowledge which is obtained by word hearing is the only subject of mind and not the senses. Except Avagraha, the other sources of knowledge, the Iha, Avaya, and Dharana, are known only through mind and not the senses. Another difference is the direct and direct knowledge, Pratyaksh Gyan, is the subject of senses, while the mind is the cause of both, direct and indirect. The subject of Shruta Gyan is only mind and not the senses. The third difference is that the senses obtain the subject of present only, while the mind obtains the substances of present, past, and future. The mind remains at the time of thinking only and not earlier or later. In other words, its thinking aspect is related to present. Remembrance is related to past. Sangya is related to present and past. Imagination is related to future. Chinta, Abhinibodh, and word knowledge are related to past, present, and future. So this is the comprehensiveness of mind. Its stages of development can be observed through the insects or beings possessing one sense to five senses. So according to Jainism, it happens due to our past karmas. Now the so far is concerned with sangyas, instincts, because man is called sangyas. So the agmic tradition uses the word sangya, which indicates the function of mind, both learnt and unlearnt. It is the knowledge of gained due to annihilation comes substance of karma. So this sangya is divided into 10 varieties. That is called, we can understand the position of mind in 10 ways: hunger, fear, carnality, possession, anger, pride, deceit, greed, discursive cognitive activity, and intuitive activity. That is called lok sangya. Now these sangyas are common to all the mundane beings, including one sense organization. So they are named as Ved in the Bhagavati Sutra. Further, they are also divided into three categories, and I need not mention all these categories. Just a minute. Now, according to Acharang Sutra Nirukti, the sangyas or instincts are divided into 14: ahar, bhay, parigraha, maithun, sukh, dukh, and so on. The shruti is caused exclusively by the mind, and therefore it cannot exist in the lower great beings that are without mind. Now, the last, this is someone. Thus, the mind in Jain tradition is of two types. One is conscious, that means chetan, and the other one is material, that is called paudgalik. The material mind assists the conscious mind. Without material mind, the conscious mind cannot function at all. It alone does not have power of knowledge. With the combination of both, the material activities come forward. The conscious mind is chetan or soul. It cannot come into existence by material anuj or parmanu. The conscious or chetan or soul is not a product of mind, but it is an independent substance. The consciousness is the exclusive quality of soul, which does not find in the matter. With the coalition of both, new qualities come forth, which are called vaibhavik guna in Jain technical language. So these qualities are four in number, that is nutriment, that means ahar, breath, swasochvas, language, bhasha, and material mind, paudgalik man. Now these qualities are neither of soul nor of body. They are in fact a product of combination of both and get destructed as soon as they are disunited. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Jain. The unique contribution of Jainism is a classification or a division between Dravyamana and Bhavamana. Dravyamana is material associated with ajiva, matter, and Bhavamana is conscious, associated with the jiva, individual self. The two have their respective functions, but the material one provides substratum for the conscious one. Without material consciousness, conscious mana, bhava mana cannot exist and cannot function as well. Now, His Holiness.
Dangun pagwe yug ngun ji kheba zo samru shivu tani takse shivu cheba chigi ku namju sewa shari sha.
So as His Holiness was saying that as he was listening to your presentation and the specificity with which the various distinctions are drawn in these Indian traditions is, you know, is a powerful evidence that in classical India, in ancient India, the deep thinkers were really very profound and comprehensive in their development of thought. With all these fine distinctions, the various, you know, avenues of reasoning and so on, and within the Buddhist tradition itself, also we see divergence of opinions. You know, some Buddhist schools like Yogacara speaks of 8 classes of consciousness. You know, in addition to the 6, they add Alayana Vijnana, the store consciousness, and Mano Vijnana, which is the Ahamkara, the I-making consciousness. Then they, you know, the Yogacara also speaks about an idealism where ultimately, you know, the perception of physical reality that we perceive are ultimately, you know, projections of our own mind, and you know there is a reasoning called constant cognition by Dharmakirti, which argues that the perception and the object of that perception is simultaneous, because they are both affirmed simultaneously, which seems to be, you know, seems to echo what we hear in quantum physics of the role of observer in almost defining what reality is. So all of these are really powerful indications of how far the classical Indian thinking, philosophical thinking, has really gone, and the kind of refinement and differentiations that people can come up, thinkers can come up with.
Indian thought is both deep and varied. So you have in-depth analysis, as at the same time you have a varied accounts, because in Jain tradition, it is believed that the reality is multi-sided. And therefore, as per different sides, there can be different accounts.
Yes. It considers through anekantvad.
And also the Buddha himself admonished his monks, saying that just as a goldsmith would test the quality of the gold through various means, in the same way, his, you know, the monastics, the monks, his monks should, you know, subject his what he has stated to scrutiny, and only on the basis of their own understanding, based on, you know, analysis, that they should accept it. So the point is that the Buddha himself also emphasized the need for, you know, inquiry, critical inquiry.
So we have 2 minutes.
Like Nagarjuna and Chandrakirti and some other actually rejected Buddha's own word. If you accept this literally, it goes against reason. Therefore, we should take liberty to reject even Buddha's own word.
For example, like Chandrakirti explicitly rejects the definitive status of a particular scripture that the Yogacara tradition holds as being definitive.
So Indian mind has not been dogmatic. It has been open-minded. I think one question we can invite from the...
So in fact, it's sort of, there's a tradition within the Indian, classical Indian, as well as in the Tibetan tradition, which inherited the Indian approach. When we make a presentation on a particular topic, we do that by first critiquing, you know, other people's positions, then presenting one's own standpoint, and then anticipating objections to that and rebutting those possible criticism of one's own position. So you can see that it is through a very analytic approach presentations are made.
In the Pali tradition, not much. Sanskrit tradition, a lot of sort of investigation and use, I think, extensively logic like that. Okay.
Now, in Indian mode of debate, there are two guiding principles. One is that reality may be one, but can be described variously. Ekam sat vipraha bahudha vadanti. And that one reality also is multi-sided. And therefore, our standpoints might be holistic or might be partial as well. So I think on behalf of the organizers, I express our heartfelt gratitude to His Holiness for his enlightened remarks and say guidance. And I also thank the paper presenters for their illuminated contributions. Thank you very much.
Now, one thing, in the philosophical field, there's a lot of differences, but everybody, including insect, one thing common, that is lunch, food.
Eating.
So, thank you very much. And now it is lunch break. And all of us will assemble at 2 o'clock sharp in the same hall for the discussion session.